Hello, my name is Chan Chia. I'm a hematologist at St Charles Gardner Hospital and Hollywood Private Hospital, and I'm the director of Blood Cancer Research WA. If you live in Western Australia, you know that we're in the middle of our first real experience of widespread community transmission of COVID-19. Now, I realise that for many of you who have suppressed immune systems and have blood cancer on treatment, this can be a very frightening time. So, I want to reassure you that there are still many things that you can do to keep yourself and your family safe. Things that we've been doing all through the pandemic, like wearing masks, hand hygiene, social distancing, and staying away from crowded, poorly ventilated places, are still going to go a long way toward keeping you and your family safe at this time. Important to remember that this is a situation that we're going to have to live with for a while, and it's important that we make changes which are sustainable for the rest of our lives while taking common sense steps to keeping ourselves safe. There are a couple of special things that you need to know if you're a patient with a blood cancer regarding COVID-19. The first is that the risk of getting severe infection is slightly higher than people who do not have blood cancers on treatment. And for that reason, it's important that if you have even mild symptoms, that you get a rapid antigen test or a PCR test if there is capacity to do so, because they are more sensitive, as soon as you can after noticing the symptoms. The reason for this is that many of the treatments that we have for COVID are effective only if given within the first 5 days from the onset of symptoms. So if you wait too long, it may be too late to actually get access to these treatments. Very important, if you have symptoms, get tested. A PCR is best. If you can't get a PCR because the lines are too long, or it's just not available, then a rapid antigen test is fine. The next thing I'll cover is what to do if you have a positive test result, either by PCR or rapid antigen test. If you have a blood cancer, and particularly if you're in an extremely high risk category, so if you're on active treatment with chemotherapy, if you're taking a tablet called a BTK inhibitor, and these include medicines like ibrutinib, acalabrutinib, and zanubrutinib, although there are many others which are commonly used for the treatment of cancers like chronic lymphocytic leukemia and mantle cell lymphoma. Well, if you've had treatment with a antibody directed at CD20, such as rituximab or obinutuzumab, within the last 12 months, if you've had a stem cell transplant, either an autologous or an allogeneic stem cell transplant within the last 12 months, and/or you're on immune suppressing medicines, or if you've had chimeric antigen receptor T cell therapy, then you are at a higher risk than even other patients with blood cancers, and you may well qualify for access to antiviral medicines or antiviral antibodies. These antibodies can be given to people without the need to be admitted to hospital, but they can only be arranged by a doctor. The doctors who are able to arrange this would be either your treating specialist or GPs, but I suspect that your specialist will be more familiar with the process than with your GP. So for that reason, if you test positive, it's important, of critical importance, that you let the specialist team treating you know about your positive results as soon as you're aware of it. If you've tested positive using a rapid antigen test, then you also need to report the positive test result via the WA Health Government website via the link that you will see on the screen now. Once you do test positive, then essentially there are 5 days in which your treating team has to work out A, whether or not you're suitable for the additional antiviral medicines, and to make the referral for that to happen. At the time of this video, the way in which the main medicine is called sitravimab, which is essentially a form of the anti-COVID protein, which is identical to what your body makes when you are vaccinated. It's given as an infusion through an intravenous drip over 30 minutes, and there will be a sitravimab clinic set up at each of the major public hospitals. Important to understand that this will primarily be a public hospital set-up treatment, and the stocks are controlled by the state government. In terms of the tablet antiviral medicines, there are a couple which seem to have activity against Omicron. The first one is called Paxlovid, and the second one is called Lagevrio. At the time of this video, the criteria for who qualify for these medicines is fairly similar to what I told you previously. If you have a heavily suppressed immune system, you may be eligible for them. However, the details about how those medicines are going to be released and made available to people are yet to be determined. So you will have to speak with your treating specialist if you get an infection to see whether that will be an option for you and how that can be done. The next thing I'm going to cover is when you should present to the emergency department. It's important to understand that the majority of patients who test positive for COVID will not require inpatient care. It seems that with Omicron, the rate of hospitalization, even among people with compromised immune systems, is much lower than with previous variants like Delta. So it is a less severe virus. However, it is still important to know when you should come to the emergency department. The common symptoms of COVID infection include fever, cough, loss of taste or smell, runny nose, and a sore throat. If your breathing becomes very labored and you feel very short of breath at rest, or very short of breath with very light exertion, or if you have very fast breathing, more than 20 breaths per minute, that does not settle down, both of those can be signs that you have low oxygen levels as a result of COVID infection of the lungs. And that may be a good marker to indicate that you should go present to your local emergency department. If you have a pulse oximeter at home, a pulse oximeter is a small electronic device which sits on your thumb and gives you a recording of your oxygen level. If you have one of these devices and it's a medical grade device, if your oxygen level measures 92% or lower, then that should be another marker to consider you going to your local emergency department, because it means that, again, you have a significant inflammation of the lungs and you may need extra oxygen, and you won't necessarily be able to get that at home. Your oxygen levels normally should be above 95% on breathing normal oxygen. Do not rely on the oxygen monitors which are embedded into your Apple Watch or your Samsung phone, because they are not medical grade and cannot be relied upon. So, just to recap the main things. Number one, please keep up your social distancing, your hand hygiene, mask wearing, and taking common sense approaches to minimize exposure to yourself and your family. Number two, if you have symptoms, then get tested. A PCR is the best test, but if the PCR testing capacity is overwhelmed, then a rapid antigen is also a good test. If you get a positive rapid antigen test reported by the government website, then tell your doctors immediately. You may be eligible for COVID antiviral medicines or infusions. If you are in a particularly high risk category, your treating specialist will be in a position to tell you if that's the case. If we don't know you've got COVID, then we can't advise you. If you are very short of breath, if you have a breathing rate of more than 20 breaths per minute, if you have low oxygen levels, those are indicators that you should present for emergency care, either by the ambulance or to your nearest emergency department. If your doctor determines that you do not qualify at this time for the specific COVID treatments, there is a COVID care at home monitoring program, which the state government has set up for people who have a positive COVID test. And the link to that is in this video above. And at that point, you can register your details, and you may be contacted by a special telehealth team who will monitor your symptoms and your progress. And you may be sent an oxygen meter and to measure your heart rate, your breathing rate, and your oxygen levels to determine whether or not you need to have any additional treatment or come to hospital. If you have any further questions, please feel free to ask your specialist, and stay safe out there.